Test 1, 2. Welcome out to our final revival service with Evangelist Steve Bowman. Let's all stand tonight, church. We're going to sing this song of praise. Amen. Let's lift our voices tonight as we sing. One thing we are. One thing we ask of you. One thing that we desire, that as we worship you, Lord, come and change. Lord, come and change our lives. Arise, 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 arise. Take your place, be enthroned on our praise. Arise, King of kings, Holy God, as we sing, arise, arise. Sing it again. One thing we are, one thing we ask, one thing we desire, one thing that we desire, that as we, yes, Lord, come and change, Lord, come and change our lives. Arise, arise, arise. Sanctuary and boldly come, Father, into your presence, worshiping you as we sing, God, have your way amongst us. Amen, church, let's focus on him tonight as we sing, as we lift our hands. Are you hurting and broken? Are you hurting and broken? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin, Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. Oh, come to the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets.
Forgiveness was born with the
worship as we sing. Oh, what a Savior.
Oh, what a Savior.
What a clap offering tonight. Father, you're worthy of your praise, Lord God. You're worthy to be magnified and glorified, Lord God, tonight. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Well, I feel revived. I feel redeemed. I feel released to do God's will. It's great to be in the house of God tonight. Can you say amen? We want to pray on this last night of revival. We're asking God to move again on our behalf. There have been many people visiting this week. There have been many people saved this week. We're praying that God would help them make the transition from simply being a convert to being a genuine Christian in a congregation. And that takes prayer on your behalf. That takes practical labor and effort. We're praying for God to help them to solidify their conversion experience, a revelation of who God is, what Jesus Christ has done for them. We're praying for God to do that upon all the new converts this week, and asking God to move upon their behalf. We're praying for the visitors that will be here on Sunday morning for the baby dedication, and people come out for baby dedications. The family and relatives and friends and so forth come out a special time for them. And so we're believing God for all the visitors on Sunday morning. We're also praying today for the many outreaches and concerts and revivals that are taking place in the month of April and the month of May in the city of Sydney. And as I begin to look at calendars and see things released on WhatsApp and so forth, there is a plethora of opportunities that we are providing the people of Sydney to get saved, to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ, hear preaching from a good Pentecostal New Testament church, and from pioneer churches to the oldest churches, holding outreaches on the streets preaching. And
We're praying for every one of those churches, every one of those events, every opportunity they have to gather a crowd and preach the gospel. We're asking God to move upon those events, gather sinners, bring conviction in the altar call, see people get saved, added to the kingdom of God. And we're asking God to help us in that arena tonight. Can you say amen? I've no doubt that by the end of the week, you've got nothing to pray for. Signed, sealed, and delivered, little bow, and off we send you. If you have any lingering problems in your life, your family, your work situation, maybe your physical health, finances, on this last night, we're lifting up those needs before the Lord and asking God to do all that He can do and what He only can do in our lives and our hearts this week. How many have got some lingering things you're going to pray for tonight? You're going to believe God as you pray. God is going to touch and help you in your life. Let's lift our hands towards heaven. Let's begin to pray. Let's begin to lay hold of God tonight. Father, we come before you tonight in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you for all that you've done this week, Lord God, and all that you're planning to do in and through our lives and congregations and fellowship tonight. Father, move upon every new convert. We pray, help them to get a deep revelation of all that Jesus Christ has done and wants to do. Add them to our congregation, Lord God, where they can become disciples and begin to pursue destiny in the kingdom of God. We're praying for every congregation in Sydney, Lord God, holding outreaches in the next 3 or 4 weeks, Lord God. Draw sinners, I pray, supernaturally attract sinners to those events, anoint the altar caller, see people converted and likewise added to your kingdom, Lord God. Help us to take all that you've done this week, apply it to our lives, and move on in a fresh anointing with a sense of revival and refreshing, Lord God. We ask all these things in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Let's give out a clap offering tonight in praise and worship. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Before you find your seats, would you turn and greet somebody? Would you make them feel welcome in the building? If there's anybody near you you don't know, go up and introduce yourself. Tell them that God has a plan for their lives. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. You can find your seats tonight. We want to welcome you out to the Potter's House. We're glad you're here. All those that have been faithful for the Parramatta Saints, we've been here since Saturday night, Sunday morning, Sunday night, all the way through tonight. And then for the men tomorrow night, a great week to be in church. No excuse not to feel saved. Amen. By the end of the week. We're glad you've been with us all week. Those visiting tonight for the very first time, I want to make you feel especially welcome. And anything we can do to help you in your Christian walk or pursuing your relationship with Jesus Christ, we're keen to do that. And we're so privileged to have you come and visit with us this evening in this last night of revival. Amen. A couple of announcements to help us on our way. Tomorrow night for the men, Pastor Steve Bowman, Evangelist Steve Bowman, is preaching a men's discipleship class. During the week, we've mentioned he's a pastor in America. He's pastored in Zambia. He was the national leader in Zambia for 11 years. Now been evangelizing around the world for about 11 years. Has no doubt great revelation and experience to bring to the men tomorrow night. 7:30 p.m. the men's D begins. We have supper here from 6:30. We encourage you to come out nice and early, get some supper with the guys, get a seat down the front where the glory comes out, and God is going to do good things in your life. Amen. Sunday morning, we have a regular Sunday morning services, a 9:30 adult Bible hour, 10:30 morning service. It's a baby dedication service. We have 4 or 5 families that are dedicating their newborns to the Lord on Sunday morning, and we devote that service to that. We preach on family. We have it's a bit of an evangelistic message for your friends and family that you bring out. That means I'm not preaching on tithing Sunday morning. Invite all of your family out, and they'll be safe. I won't, and a short offering if that's going to help you. But to bring them out on Sunday morning, they'll see what we do here with the baby dedication as opposed to all other forms of Christian baby rituals and so forth, and they hear the gospel preached that Sunday morning at 10:30, 6:30 Sunday evening, of course, next Wednesday again in church at 7:30 p.m. Prayer every morning, every weekday morning from 6:30. A couple of other dates just to be aware of. Number one is our conference is coming up. There's a poster on the back wall there, Mastering Ministry Mountains. It's going to be on September the 2nd through Friday the 6th, again at the Stanhope Leisure Center. We're going to have to rent out another extra basketball court to facilitate the size of the crowd, which is good news to have. But I would encourage everybody from our congregation, especially, we absolutely need all hands on deck. I mean, I was reading the other day that in the tabernacle, it took 300 men to take down the veil before the Holy of Holies every time they had to move it or every time they had to clean it. In other words, it's out there in the desert. Took 3 men days to get it down, get it sorted out and tied it up. In other words, Christianity is a busy business. And these all hands on deck, especially at conference. We are the host church, and I would encourage everybody that can to get the week off work as you possibly can, and help us, especially Monday when we begin to move this church all the way over there. It's a very labor-intensive day. That's why we're giving you the dates this early. Monday, the 2nd of September, if you can get that off especially, that'll be a great day to get off. Help us. But Monday through Friday, the 2nd to the 6th for conference. The last announcement is our next 180 concert, and Alex is going to come and give us a bit of a message about that.
Amen. Next Saturday, on the calendar, it says Students Against Bullying. We haven't cancelled that. We've just rescheduled that. We're going to do that at a later date. Next Saturday, we have the Fairfield band coming, along with an impact team. So next Saturday, the concert is going to be amazing. We're going to be down on the streets in the afternoon, along with the Fairfield team. They're going to come in the afternoon. I encourage everyone to plan out, plan to be there in the afternoon down at the mall. But more importantly, for the nights, they're doing a full acoustic concert. They're dressing up the stage here. They're doing everything. I've seen clips of it. It's amazing. We're framing it around mental health. If you don't think mental health is relevant, read the news for 2 minutes. Every single news story mentions mental health. The reason why it's so relevant is because the world really doesn't have an answer for mental health. But we know that Jesus Christ is the answer. So let's take some flyers. Let's be inviting people out. It talks about mental health on there. The statistic is 1 in 5 people struggle. Really, it's every single one of us struggle. Without Jesus, we're all lost. So let's be inviting people along. The Fairfield Impact Team and the Fairfield Band are coming next Saturday. It's going to be an amazing time.
Amen. On the calendar, it says 10:30, but because the impact team is coming from Fairfield, we've moved that to 2:30. And so it's 2:30 in the afternoon that they can come, help us with the outreach on the streets, and then they're going to come back here and practice and get ready for the evening. And so that's going to be a blessing for that. We want to receive a love offering tonight on the last night of revival. Let's give the Lord a clap offering as he has come forward this evening. This is a special offering, and the Bible has lots to say about love offerings, or honorariums, we call them in a more technical sense. This is an offering that is taken typically on the last night of revival. In smaller churches, they might take it on the last 2 nights of revival in order to make sure that the visiting speaker gets adequately recompensed for his labor. In the Old Testament, there's a great story where Naaman the leper calls on Elisha, or goes and visits Elisha for a miracle of healing and asks him to pray for him. He's come back and forth there. In the end, he goes and dips 7 times in the Jordan River. And Naaman, who's a Syrian, he's not a Christian, he's not from the people of God, he's a Syrian, he gets healed. And the very first thing on his mind when he gets healed is, I ought to give an offering to the man of God who's brought me the message that brought about my redemption, brought about my healing and my deliverance. And you can read the story yourself there in the Bible. For various reasons, Elisha chooses not to receive that offering. That's not our scope here tonight. But I'm saying two things. Number one was that Naaman's first response after having received ministry from Elisha is, I ought to be a blessing to this guy. And our challenge tonight is we've been here all week. We've been blessed, whether you've simply heard encouraging messages, whether God gave you a personal word, whether you've been prayed for bodily healing, whether you've simply been refreshed by the Holy Ghost by being in church where our brother has been preaching and ministering. We've all been blessed, and your natural response ought to be, how can I be a blessing to the man of God? Well, he doesn't want a magnet for his fridge. That's nice. He doesn't want a bookmark for his wife's Bible. That's nice. But the Bible says that those that preach the gospel ought to live of the gospel. And so Elisha chose in the Old Testament not to receive the offering. Our evangelists here in 2024, they are full-time evangelists. That means that the only income that pastor receives this week is the income that we give him. And how much do you earn tonight? Are you being blessed? Well, the Bible says that you ought to at least think about being able to contribute towards a blessing to his ministry that would give him a week's wages. But hold on there, there's more. The Bible says he's worthy of double portion. That means, yeah, amen. I should take some of your love offerings for you. Amen. That'll help you. But the Bible says double portion. In other words, receiving spiritual input ministry that has, as I've mentioned, is about 30 or 40 years in the making. And the gifting that he brought to us this week, the Bible says that he is worthy of a double portion. Your natural response ought to be, how can I bless him? Number two, how can I participate in an offering that gives him at least 1 week's wages? He has a wife, he has a house, he has a mortgage, he has to maintain a car, he's got to keep lots of things. He's just like you. And thirdly, is we ought to think about giving a double portion offering that you could contribute. If you look down at what's in your hand tonight, if you look down to what you're thinking of contributing online, if you think about how that will add together, will this reward this man in an apt and a valuable way for all that he's done this week and all that he's brought to us? We want to be a blessing tonight. Can you say amen? We're a liberal congregation. You've always been generous towards visiting ministry. I've no doubt tonight will be the same. This has been a longer revival than normal, and we want to be a blessing to our brother. Let's bow our heads and pray. I would ask you to think about the things that I've said. Let God speak to you about an amount of money to give into the offering. If you don't have the cash to give, then you can give online by the means behind me. If you don't have cash and you don't have access to give by the means you have behind me, you can write an amount of money on a piece of paper that you'll bring in by Sunday. And, you know, I've got no cash, I've got no access to the online giving. I'm going to give this amount of money. We'll honor that before he leaves, and you can put in the offering on Sunday and take care of that. Amen. We want God to bless our brother and recompense him for his valuable ministry and his investment in the kingdom of God, our fellowship, and in particular our congregation this week. Amen. I wonder if Trent would ask for God's blessing on the gift and the giver this evening. Amen. Mighty is our God. Mighty is our God. Mighty is our King. Mighty is our Lord. Creator of heaven. His name is higher. His name is higher. Higher than any other name. His power is greater. 'Cause he created everything. Mighty is our God. Mighty is our God. Mighty is our King. Mighty is our Lord. Creator of everything. Amen. Appreciate the song service. Let's give the song service a warm hand. They've been great all week and have helped us to worship God. Amen. Well, I've had a tremendous week. I've got another day with our brother tomorrow and then the men's day tomorrow night, but I've had a great time. I've not known him. I did have a cup of coffee in Zambia with him many years ago, But tremendous blessing to have spent a week of fellowship with him. He's the real deal. And happy to say that. He's a man of integrity, a man without guile. I've richly been blessed by fellowship with him this week, as well as the ministry in the evenings. Let's give him a warm Potter's House last night. Welcome as he comes tonight.
Turned it off. No, it's on. Good, because you didn't hear me singing in the beginning. Hallelujah. I always try to mute the microphone in case my singing makes strange noises, you know. And I want to say tonight, as we turn to the book of Revelation in chapter number 7, that I do thank God this evening that at least in our fellowship, we believe that He Himself gave some to be evangelists. And it would be probably very easy in a group this large tonight to make the valid statement, well, if God is really behind your ministry, he'll meet your need. And you are exactly correct in that assumption. But never forget, He meets that need through you. So I would say tonight, and bear with me, if you happen to speak the local dialect there in Central Africa, there in Zambia, you speak Nyanja, I would say to you, Zikomo Kumbwili. Yes, there will be a test. If you happen to be from the Belgian Congo, I could say to you, Merci beaucoup. If you speak some Russian, Spasiba. If you happen to be from at least southern province in China, the only part I've been to, Shishe. If you happen to speak Dutch, dankjewel. If you happen to speak Korean, that my wife does, I could say to you, komapsmida. Or if you're a K-popper, komapso. If you speak Portuguese, obrigado. If you speak Tagala, salamat. And if you happen to speak the heavenly language back where I live in Prescott, Arizona, I would say to you tonight, muchas gracias. Thank you so very much for your faithfulness this week and tonight for your sacrifice in the love offering. Praise God. I'm looking forward to what He's going to do. It wouldn't be right. I leaned over to our sister and I said, is that Rod Gibson, the legend? Wow. But you know, and I hope you don't take this wrong. It's too bad there's no refund on the love gift. But if you're just like plumb wore out and you're like, my God, do I live my whole life in church? You're not going to like heaven. Heaven is kind of like forever. And we do thank God for the hospitality of Pastor and Ann. They are good folks. Amen. Some of you are egg yolks. They're good folks. So it all depends on how you scramble it. Hallelujah. What a blessing, the fellowship we have. You guys are blessed to have them as your leaders here. What God is doing in this congregation, I sense from our very first service. We don't surf in Arizona. But, you know, I just sense like this wave that is building. It's not crested. It's building. And I believe this conference, you are going to see such a supernatural outpouring and a multiplication because we are living in the last days. And if ever you want to do something for God, it ought to be in this lifetime because that's all you get is one per customer. Thank you, Jesus. I sense the Lord tonight. The faithfulness of God triumphs over all of our own inadequate feelings, our discouragements, and all the things that we think that would disqualify us from being the young man of God that you are. But I want to remind you tonight that we are literally signing on His ticket. That His goodness and His faithfulness, young man, they will be with you every step of the way. And I say tonight, don't be so down on yourself. You can believe for this guy or that girl. But yet in your own heart, you're pretty hard on yourself. Never good enough, never fast enough. Enough is enough. While we were yet sinners, naughty by nature and choice, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. How much more tonight, when you and I are trying to do our best, he'll be found by you, my friend, to be exactly as he always has been, faithful and true. Can we give God some praise tonight? I do sense him. I do. Thank God. God's faithfulness is real to us. You know, and Brother John, who was banished to an island called Patmos, it doesn't matter if it looked like Hawaii or not. He was banished, and it was there he saw into the book I'm going to quote from tonight, and he said, "Behold, I saw him who sat upon the throne, and he did say to me, write, behold, I make all things brand new." Not an update, not an upgrade. God's going to do something real tonight at the conclusion of this service. He's going to do something fresh, and it's going to be new. I believe with all of my soul that the very best days that we have are the ones right now in front of us. Thank you, Jesus. You know, for 11 years, give or take, 11 years, living in Zambia there, our church was 99.98% black. Could you guess the 0.02? It would be the Korean girl and the mixed up boy. And yet what I found to be so true in the first 3 months is that prejudice or racial, whatever you want to call it, it is not a shade. It's a mindset. And tonight, the scripture that we want to look at, it is literally the great gathering. That this is literally tonight all-inclusive. And as I have been just a short time back in this part of Australia, the greater Sydney area, it is like looking out on the United Nations everywhere I go in our churches. You don't have to necessarily go across the world to reach another people group. But you may have to go across the street. I'm just saying. But tonight I want to look at this because in our church there in Zambia, there were some young people. These would be post-war children from the Congo. These would be young people that came in from families that the mom or the dad or sometimes even both died of HIV/AIDS. The kids are handed from family to family. And when they came into the tent in those earlier days, Jesus saved their soul and God began to do something no program could ever do. He gave them hope. And it so really affected our nation because in Zambia, there are, I think, 73 tribes. In our area, we had all 17 tribes in one church. That was a miracle. But tonight I want to finish this revival off well because revival doesn't stop tonight. You come back on Sunday with the same faith, the same attitude. I'm telling you, it's the same God that's going to meet with you guys. But I want to look tonight. This is a picture here in Australia. It's a picture in the throne room of God. And I want to look tonight at the great gathering. Revelation chapter number 7. I'll be making mention of other places. It wouldn't be right to not mention something out of Revelation. But I really worked on this last night and this afternoon to finish. The Bible says in verse number 9, "After these things I looked, and behold, a great multitude which no one could number of all nations, tribes, peoples and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes, with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, saying, Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. The great gathering. I have to deal with this, and that's to mention to you tonight the truth about life. Okay? Okay? One thing Uncle Steve will always do is give you my best, and I'll tell you the truth. And the truth about life is that almost everyone I've ever met, almost everyone I run into, somewhere will face some kind of hurt, some kind of setback, some kind of disappointment in life, either self-inflicted or through somebody else. Don't shout me down. Job said it well in Job 5 and 6. He says, "For affliction does not come from the dust, nor does trouble spring from the ground. Yet man is born to trouble as the sparks fly upward." See, trouble and pain, and I'll mention it several times before we close, injustice is an equal opportunity afflictor. Does it matter where you've come from? Does it matter your social or educational background? Affliction, setbacks, issues in life, they are no respecter of persons. John 16, 33 in the Amplified, Jesus, he said, "I've told you these things so that in me you may have perfect and complete peace and confidence. In the world you will have some tribulation and trials and distress and frustration. But be of good cheer. Take courage. Be confident, certain, undaunted. For I have overcome the world." Literally, it meant in this translation, "I have deprived this world of power to harm you, and I've conquered the world for you." See, as Christians, we all would recognize that great and terrible day. But what is so encouraging with all that's going on in the world today, I'm not political. I don't ever use a sacred desk like this one in Parramatta to be political. But between Russia, the Ukraine, the Middle East, what planet do you live on, friend? Jesus is coming. And yet, in spite of all those things, you know, people, they lose heart. People lose hope. All that's going on in the world, what in the heck is going on? Young man today asked me, he goes, "What in the hell's going on?" I go, "That's a great way to ask." Well, we need to know that God is faithful. Praise His name. See, no matter what's going on in the world today, and there's a lot of things not right, can I remind you? God is for us. That went over really well. God is for us. And even right now, Jesus is pulling for you. There's always been injustice in the world, hasn't there? Come on, class. Remember. The quick point one is the truth about life. There has always been injustice. There has always been things in life that aren't fair. All the way back to the Garden of Eden, it was perfect. And they received their instructions not from their pastor, not from a visiting speaker from Arizona. They got their intel from God Himself. It was pretty straightforward. "Of all of this, you may freely eat. But that tree," which one? "That one? Yes. That's my tree. Don't touch it." Pretty straightforward. But amazingly enough, as important as that was, there were no alarm systems built around the tree. There was no razor wire like they do in South Africa. There were no angels standing there at AK-777s. "Halt! Who goes there? The way was wide open, wasn't it? And sometimes we forget God has given you and me one of the greatest gifts humanity can understand, the gift of a free will choice. They chose wrongly. Yes, God did have to drive them from the garden, but it's very interesting. He didn't destroy marriage. He didn't destroy the family. Injustice, when an innocent brother was murdered by his other brother, just out of jealousy and spite. And God says, why is your countenance fallen? If you do well, it'll be all right. But sin, it crouches at your door. Injustice. Joseph, we mentioned him earlier in the week. Joey didn't ask for all that. And the greatest injustice of all was what our wrongdoings did to Jesus on the cross. You talk about not fair. He willingly stepped in front of me and took my place on the cross. We sing sometimes, he lived the life that I should have lived, but we didn't, did we? We made some mistakes, some oopsie-slipsies along the way. But I want to remind us tonight, yes, the perilous times have come, but there's always been pain. There's always been injustices in life. And God from his throne has watched it all. And he never sleeps nor slumbers, nor does he grow discouraged. I'm going to say it again. God is for us. Many times it's in the trials. Many times it's in the pain. We focus on all that's going on that's wrong, don't we? Instead of what the Lord is doing. Isaiah 45:7, he says, I form the light and create darkness. I make peace and create calamity. I, the Lord God, do all these things. In Revelation 21:5, in the Amplified, it says, and he who is seated on the throne said, see, I make all things new. Also, he said, record this, for these sayings are faithful, they're accurate, they're incorruptible and trustworthy. Friends, we have to believe God in these last days. My prayer for us in the greater Sydney area and this Candlestick Church, God, that you would please multiply our effectiveness in the last days. God, that you yourself would open doors of opportunity for cities and nations. That we could redeem the time that's been set before us. It's easy to see from our text. And you hang in there, I'm not preaching false doctrine. You'll see in a minute. These around the throne, they came out of the great tribulation. But as I'm reading this last night late and today in my life application study Bible, the point in that is they came out of it. They didn't blame everybody else for their problems. We live in a generation that is absolutely professional at blaming everybody else. This is the most frustrated generation ever in the history of mankind. And they knew. No blame, nobody else's fault. And what it really is for us in 2024, sometimes, yes, we throw our hands up and just praise him. But we have to make sense out of the senseless. How many has ever woken up and you realize life forces us to make decisions every day? In Arizona, it does. The hope that we have tonight is that even if people do us wrong, if we do right, God goes with us. Abram, he gives his nephew Lot a start in life, takes him in, gives him a starting business. They both thrive. You know the story. He's like, Lot, this is not good. Our kinfolk are striving. They're arguing and foreigners are watching. It's not good. If you want to go to the right, I'll go to the left. You want to go left, I'll go right. Because Abram knew something. Whichever way he went, if he would do right, God would go with him. This is the hope we have tonight, friends, isn't it? I had something totally different planned out. Ha-ha, rah-rah. But with what's going on right now in the world, the issue is not, will Israel retaliate? The issue is not, what is their next plan? My question, what is your plan? You better stay right. And I know way too many people in the last 2 years or so, they're just dropping out of the race. What? Falling prey to immorality or whatever else it might be. What? There's always been injustice in the world ever since the fall of man. And my point tonight before I bless on is this. No matter what you have done in life, tonight, you can be forgiven. You can be free. You can have a brand new start. And that brings us not just the truth about life, but the truth about God. Here in verse 9, it says, after this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no one could number, of all nations and kindreds and peoples and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes, with palms in their hands. God has always had dominion in history. You may think tonight it's El Diablo 10, you nil. Depends on who's keeping score, is it? Don't be a bato loco from East LA, huh? God will always have dominion. No matter what the satanic forces seem to be doing, and no matter what's going on, God is still sovereign. And even right now, God is seated on the throne. Even Isaiah 6, in the year King Uzziah died, heartbreaking. He was a good king. They were seeing revival. And he said, in the year King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and lifted up, seated on the throne. That even in our own heartbreaks, our own spinouts, our own failures, God is still sovereign and seated on the throne. And he very much is seated on the throne in history right now. Can I get a witness? See, tonight you can't let injustice, you can't let personal things, or especially politics, rob you and me of the truth of God's sovereignty. My life is not in the hands of a politician. Neither is yours. Our lives are in the hand of God. I don't know what's going to happen in November where I live, but I know I'm voting Jesus back in. So easy with our carnal minds to think and look at the world we live in. It's hopeless, and the church is losing power and impact. And, people are dropping out of church. Well, I see you here tonight. See, it all depends on your perspective. Maybe what you zero in on is the empty chair. I'm looking at the filled one with you in it. Every one of you here tonight, you are a miracle. I'm going to say walking, but you're actually sitting down right now. Don't walk out, please. Matthew 16, 18 in the Amplified, Jesus says, I tell you, you are Peter, in the Greek, Petros, a large piece of rock. And on this rock, I will build my church, and the gates or the strategies or the prevailing powers shall not overpower the church or lay siege and victory against it. Our God has always had a witness in the earth. He's always had a remnant, hasn't he? And I know that what we stand for here in the greater Sydney area, I know what we stand for back in Prescott, Arizona, it's going to be even more challenged in these last days. This is why we need to know what we believe and why. Well, Pastor Walsh said, the book of Anne. No, you need to know what you believe. That is, Paul said, I am persuaded. He is able to keep that which I committed unto him until that day. What day? That day. Even in hurt, confusion. Please don't lose hope, okay? Don't lose heart. Because here in our text, the throne is a picture of dominion. It's a picture of honor. It's a picture tonight of glory. And sometimes in real life and sometimes the things that go on, it wants to empty our hearts of hopes and dreams. Some of you here tonight used to believe for things. And now because of world conditions, you've kind of let them slip away. God wants you to lay hold of them again tonight. Because even if our hearts feel emptied, the throne is filled. Always. Sometimes in our own hurts, we forget the plan and the purpose that God has for us. These people described in our text, they're Gentiles of all nations, tribes, peoples, and tongues. And they stand before the throne. God is there, the Lamb of God, and it says their robes were washed white. And they've got palm branches. That's a picture of victorious. See, we can't forget tonight this. People may try to put you young people, put us others that our IDs lie. People may try to put us in their mold. They may try to discredit us or discourage us. But these in our text would not be put out. They were standing in front of the throne. And what I do, in the face of abject darkness and injustice in the world right now, I'm telling you, friends, in the darkest times of humanity's history, God was always victorious. Even when hell thought they've won, Satan entered Judas. He's been buried in a borrowed grave, Siegfried. There's your first clue, Sherlock. He didn't need it but for 3 days. And the Bible tells us that if Satan and his cohorts knew what would have happened after Jesus rose from the dead, they never would have crucified the Son of God. El Diablo is not as smart as some people think he is. And I love it. Not a single tribe will be missed. All are welcome. And that brings us tonight to the whole point. The truth about their message. Verse 10, and crying out with a loud voice, saying, salvation belongs to our God and him who sits on the throne. and to the Lamb. Never forget tonight, our salvation is attributed only to Jesus. These numberless people in heaven proclaim their salvation didn't come from their good works. It didn't just come because they're martyred, and we'll get to that in a minute. They said salvation belongs to our God and the Lamb. They're not there and saved because of a priest or an organization, but because they believed in what Jesus had done for them. And I must say right here, this is not necessarily true of you. I know it's not true of me. But there are way too many people today that proclaim they're Christians, but they're silent in their witness. How can you have what he's given us and not speak of him? It's not right to not speak up. And this is where we make a choice on this Thursday night once again. We're going to separate ourselves from this falling everyday world. We're going to choose to separate and be real Christians. You know, real ones? That, as I said on Sunday night, and it went over fairly well, I believe the greater Sydney area has a right to see a real Christian. A real one. That they watch how we deal with loss and setback. They watch how we react. How could you be happy? I thought you told me your cat got run over.
Yeah.
How could you be happy? Well, I'm thinking about the money I'm saving on cat food. Now, come on. My wife loves animals too much. I asked her, she goes, well, you say that, and it was fine. If my wife, Jeannie, would have been Noah's wife, she'd have sunk the ark. Look over there, hubby. What? Come on, couple more. Come on. But you're going to have to get a positive perspective, or you're going to be a victim. Right. This is what brought one of the greater breakthroughs in those early days in Zambia. There was no Lozi tribe. Bemba and Ngozi, they were all one. It may not look like it on the outside, but you know, we're all family. Oh yeah, we are family. We have one Father tonight, if you're a Christian. We are one tribe. We are of one blood. And this is where we want to pray. These had their robes washed and white. This is the hope you could have tonight if you've come this evening and you're not a genuine Christian. No matter what, you can be washed. And we won't take all the time. We mentioned it this week. Lepers in the Bible. The woman with the issue of blood. On and on. People were made clean from Jesus Christ. Can you say amen? But. You think things out there are bad now? You think people out there, some of them could be mean now? Can we even begin to comprehend when God lifts you and me in the rapture? We'll talk it. When God lifts his spirit off the earth, the world will finally get what they thought they wanted, a world without God. And they're not going to like it. These were martyred. In our text, they literally had to give their life. You and I tonight, we have hope 1 Thessalonians 4:17 on your own. 1 Corinthians 15 on your own in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye. We that belong to the Lord will be caught up in a moment. When the trumpet of God sounds, we shall be raised and meet those who have gone on before us. I want to tell you tonight, you young people, moms and dads, you don't want to play games. It is probable, this numberless multitude, I understand they came out of the great tribulation. But I don't care who the Antichrist is. I don't care about the number of the beast. You can have my house. Just feed the dog. We're going up. I'm telling you tonight, the hope that we have tonight, if you're here, you're not right with God. You don't have to go through that. You tonight can be forgiven. You tonight, no matter what you've done, you can be free. And don't tell me, well, you know, I missed the rapture. I still got my girlfriend and I got my homeboys and all that. No, if you can't live for God in the victory now, it'd be very, very difficult to make it through. And they, the Bible tells us, they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. This is, and the word of our testimony. And they love not their lives unto death. I don't know what Israel's next plan is going to be. I don't know. I do care. I don't know. But I'm telling you, I believe with all of my soul, Pastor Mitchell, till the week before he passed on and I went out of town, he believed with all of his heart and he put it in me. He goes, Bowman, I'm telling you, God's promise in the original, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. And then, and in the original, parenthesized, and only then, the end will come. He said, I believe in the very last days before the rapture, God's going to cause such a revival that will eclipse the Jesus people revolution in the 70s. You and I have unprecedented possibilities of potential in this service tonight that we could reach our generation for Jesus Christ. We, if you care about your friends, tell them about Jesus now. Because the gathering, the great gathering in our text, it is for all. And tonight, you can know that you know you left this service right with God. Can we bow our heads tonight, please, and close our eyes just for a moment? Again, I totally in my mind, my heart, but not my spirit, had something else already planned. But with all that's going on in the world today, I wouldn't be really right to not mention something out of Revelation. And prophecy is not my absolute forte. I keep up on prophecy. But I'm an evangelist. This is a revival. Tonight, while we're pausing before we pray for absolute long-term medical conditions to be healed, the mind assaults I've been sensing tonight in the prayer room on some, the anguish and the worry. God's going to give peace. Deliverance for some tonight. The habit that you once thought you had control over, now it's got you. As I mentioned, life forces us sometimes to make choices and make decisions. And at the time, it looked so right, felt so right. But then over time, this is not the way you want your story to go. The word of hope I bring tonight, you can change. God is here this evening, no matter what you've done. No matter how long it's been, no matter how badly you think you've stumbled and fallen, in a moment of time, your own decision, free will choice is a powerful thing. But God will hold us accountable for it. Tonight, maybe you've come on this Thursday night of revival service and you do not have the assurance inside of your sins forgiven. Maybe at one time you did, but you allowed the peer pressure, you allowed friends or family to push or pull you off base, and tonight you know you're a prodigal. 2024, prodigal son or prodigal daughter. And yet tonight, you want to get right with God. I don't know how you would sleep at night not being right with God in these days. But tonight, there are several here. You want to get right with God this evening. You want to rededicate your life to Jesus. And if that is you, friend, right where you are, just as you are, would you lift up your hand just quickly to keep you in prayer? Amen. Just slip your hand right up. Put it right back down so that we can pray together tonight. Preacher, I want to be forgiven tonight. I want to rededicate my life to Jesus. Slip your hand up, would you? Put it right back down. We are going to pray tonight together. Thank God. Then tonight, the great gathering, while the world wants to blame COVID or whatever else it is, you know, the hope that I have tonight, that I have some very good family members, some friends, my pastor, Glenn Cluck, Ron Bennett, others, Dennis Wright. You see, tonight to the Christian, it's not a river ditchy. It's not goodbye. It's till we meet again. Yes, it does hurt when we lose a loved one. Yes, it does affect us. I'm not saying it doesn't. But tonight on this Thursday night, whether you're a teenager struggling through identity crisis, the peer pressure to conform and all those things, whether you're a mom or a dad, tonight you're a widow or a widower, can I remind you again tonight, every trial, every temptation, everything we go through, it is going to be worth it all. Tonight, some of you, you have the victory, then the next day, because you're so caught up in the world news. We need to be relevant. We need to. But some of you, you're so caught up in the world news. We got to get our head back in the good news, the Word of God. I've read to the end. We win. But while we're going through the pain, while we're going through the trying times, we need to be reminded tonight, God is high. He is seated on the throne. And He really is in control, friends. Twice, while living those years in Zambia, I got a phone call from the American ambassador. Is this Stephen Bowman? Wow, formal, maybe. This is Mr. All That. There's been an attempted coup last night in Zambia. We don't know the way it's going to go. I want you to get your wife, Jeannie, your passports, and you make your way to the embassy, and if things get really bad, we'll promise to get you out. Tonight, isn't that what we are, friends? We're the ambassadors for Christ. Read your Bible for what it says, the seals and the judgments of God. COVID wasn't a judgment of God. I don't understand why He allowed it, but He did. But if you read the Word of God for what it says, those judgments and those seals when they're broken, and still they did not repent, and still they did not turn from their sorceries, hey, listen, we've already repented, haven't we? God's not going to allow you and me to go through that. You need to get your doctrine straight. We are 100% assured. The pre-tribulation rapture is our portion. And I don't know all that's going on in the world today, but as we see the news unfolding, the soon return of the Lord is near, and He will take His people to be with Him. You don't want to be left behind. Make your stand strong. Make tonight your election sure. hold on to what I said. Revival continues Sunday. Bring someone with you. If you really care about that friend, tell them about Jesus now. And on this Thursday night, many needs, as our pastor said. I think there's still a few wrinkles that need to be ironed out, some people that don't feel well. Tonight, maybe some mind assaults, maybe some financial needs I am feeling tonight. Every one of you could know, some of you are struggling financially. Can't even find the ends to make a meet. But I want to remind you tonight, He is still Jehovah Jireh. He can make sure that spiritual bin of flour does not run out and that spiritual bin of oil, cruse of oil, does not run dry. He is faithful, and He can enlarge and expand our resources in these very expensive last days. Tonight, in your own personal heart, you want to believe God for a renewed effectiveness. You want to hold on to the hope. And yes, there's always been problems in mankind's history, but thanks be to Him who sat upon the throne, and He sits there right now, and He's pulling for you, friends. And this is why we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses. We run our race to win. And tonight, you need a healing. Tonight, you need a miracle in your mind, in your body. A breakthrough job in your finances, just maybe nothing less. I want God to refresh me tonight that I'd make a stand for Jesus in these last days. God, speak into your heart tonight. As we stand in this place, I want to open up this altar once again. For those that feel that stirring the way I do, my goodness, I have met so many people since being here. A week and a half ago, last Saturday. People that I want to reach. People that I witnessed to and reached out to. But I don't live here. You do. And tonight you want and need a fresh touch of God. Encouragement. A healing with your name on it tonight. And that is you. Can we stand this evening? And again, you want a fresh touch of God, come and join me right here, would you? We do want to pray. Just come and stand. We want to seal this tonight. So I heard someone in the prayer room there. It was just so apropos. God, seal it tonight. That's what we want to do. Not seal a meal. We're going to seal the deal. God's coming for His church. He's coming for His church. Say tonight to the Gibson tribe, the faithfulness of God, it's so real. The things you've seen God do through your own hands in the lives of others, God wants to remind us tonight again. He will enlarge. He will expand and cause the fruitfulness you've been praying for, Brother Rod, to be multiplied. I'm talking about fruit that goes up over the wall is what God has for you and your family and the heritage. It is absolutely stunning what I sense. And my sister would be my only witness. I leaned over. Is that Rod Gibson, the legend? What you stand for and what we do in life, it matters. Sometimes we don't see all that right there at that time. But I am saying tonight, we are part of something supernatural. And He Himself gave some, my brother, to be evangelists. We need you. God tonight wants to encourage your wife. God tonight wants to encourage your family. Whatever we want to call it, on loan from God. But God's going to multiply. God's going to grant such a grace and such a mercy in your lives like never before. You're going to know it's the hand of God. I'll tell you, God's in house tonight. He's in house. And He wants us tonight to not just speak well of Him. And I know you do. But the greatest testimony in the world we have today, it doesn't come from a book, doesn't come from a video series. The greatest testimony we have of the ongoing, genuine work of God, it's marriage and the family. And sometimes the enemy wants to assault all of us. I understand that. But my sister, all those anxieties and all those fears the enemy tries to put in your mind about your kids, all those things you're worried about, they're not going to happen. Don't spend today fretting about tomorrow. God's got you guys covered over in His blood. And He wants to prosper. He wants to bless you guys like never, ever before. As we are, to become who He wants us to be. Now we are the children of God. And we do not yet know. But we one day soon will be like Him, for we shall see Him as He is. Stand strong, you guys, as you have been. Thank God for being faithful pillars in the house of God. Remember, He gave some, not all, He gave some to be pastors, prophets, evangelists, but He definitely gave you two to us as a great gift. Don't discount what God's doing. Don't you love Jesus? I want to give you a nickel. Do you have nickels here? 5 cent pieces? 5 cents? I mean, okay, sorry. We have to be people of reality. Is your wife here? You are. Would you come over here? There is no fear in love. My brother, perfect love casts out all fear. And I think it was Sunday night, just as we were all praying, your wife had that warm feeling go down to that nerve and she was healed. I'm telling you tonight, you are not a second-class, second-rate Christian citizen, brother. You and your wife are first-class. And it really does matter if you guys were not here. You're not a square peg, my brother, in a round hole. You fit, and you can take this home to your wife. This is a place not only where we belong, it's a place we can still become all that God wants to do for us. Oh, I sense Him. I really do. Our hearts are not just open books to God, but they're tablets. And we write His word on the tablets of our hearts, right? Don't let life turn your heart to a piece of stone. Well, bite the bullet, Gipper. We do all things to please Him who enlisted us into His family. And of all the prayers that I pray, are many. I want to make a difference. And I want to finish well. I don't want to be a proverb. I don't want to be a byword. I don't want to be a funny story. And if the Lord tarries, I certainly don't want. And I know my wife, Jeannie, she'll just put me in a coffee cup and but I hope one day it doesn't say, here lies Stevie Ray Bowman. He was so funny. Oh no. I hope someone somewhere reminds and remembers you and me, people that cared. And when we care, we share. God's going to spare you, young man, from something potentially hurtful down the road. He's going to spare you. You keep your eyes fixed on the prize. You keep your eyes fixed on the things above. The enemy of our soul, he doesn't just want us back. He wants damaged goods. And I'm saying it again, you keep faithful and God is going to spare you from some real hurt and harm down the road. Don't let other people decide your destiny. I think you have a right to do that. You love Jesus tonight? How faithful he is to us. Choosing us, that just trips me out. This church is fruitful. Five baby dedications just this week. There'd be a bunch more coming. I can just feel it. Could be the water. But when I was born, they asked my mom, is it a boy or a girl? It's a humanoid. Nowadays, people got to get the 15 baby books. They got to know everything ahead of time. That's not wrong. But when you have a child, normally you get what you get. Never forget how powerful adoption really is. Adoption is taking somebody for what they already are. And that's what God did for all of us. He adopted us into his family, my sister. And what it means for us, he wants us to be with him forever. That is so great news for you and me. They that do the will of God shall abide as the stars in the heavens forever. And I know tonight, don't grow weary in well-doing. I know it's still growing weary. But God tonight wants to give you, my sister, a grace and a strength to stand and make such a difference in these days. Thank God. We're going to pray tonight. Believe in God. Believe in God. And what he wants to do and what he wants to say. It's substantially more, my brother and sister, than you see right now. If is like so poquito in the English language. Just two letters. If. It's life-changing. If there be anything praiseworthy, if there be anything of a good report, if there be anything of decency and honesty, think on those things. And I stand against the lies of the enemy, sister, trying to get your mind thinking about what you think is not happening. I'm here to tell you what God is doing. It's real, it's lasting, and it's on you guys tonight. The blessing of the Most High God, it's worth going for. Can I believe him tonight? And I want you this evening to put your hands onto your heart. And again, I so thank God for your faithfulness. I thank God for your pastor and Ann for the incredible memory I take with me from this place. First time in Sydney, I'm ruined. And I want you to pray this evening and say, my Father in heaven, no matter what I sense or I see, in the present circumstances called our world, God, tonight I refocus, I recenter my vision on you. Tonight I am your child, called by your name, washed in your blood, And I thank you tonight for the impact you've made in my life. And now I ask that you will help my life to make impact in the lives of others. Thank you for such a multicultural city and church and nation that I get to live in. I thank you for our pastor and Ann. God, like never before, I will stand with them. And my brothers and sisters, we shall shake this city. We shall shake the nations in these last days. All tribes, the great gathering that you are doing in these days, thank you for letting me be a part. Release healing in my physical body. I break pain, all fear, worry, and anxiety, every disease, every infection, I break its hold. And Father, tonight, I willingly ask you to break habits, mindsets, and attitudes that are not of you. Have your way in all of my future days. I thank you for what you've done, but I so thank you for all that you're going to do. In Jesus' name, I pray, amen. Let's give our God praise. God bless every one of you as our pastor comes.
Glory be to God. Amen. God is good. Forever to be praised. Appreciate you being out tonight, all that God has done this week. Appreciate those who are faithful all week and those that helped to make it happen. We appreciate that. I'll be praying for Sunday. We're asking God to bring the converts back and see them established in the kingdom of God. The baby dedication, we're looking forward to that. And the dates I gave you, God is good. Let's bow our heads to pray and ask for God's blessing upon us as we go. I wonder if Shane would seal us off in prayer tonight. Amen. Good evening. God bless you. If you get a chance to speak to Pastor before he leaves, that'll be great. Otherwise, we'll catch you on Sunday. Amen.
If you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies. If you're trying to feel the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. We've all searched for the light of day.